Okay, in this anket, few asked an important question. Başak and Özlem and several other people. Buse Yıldırım, Ahmet Salih Gündoğdu. Anyway, the question essentially is, why does the charge you are asking on the outside, the charge minus Q on the outside sphere in this example, why does it not contribute? Okay. Well, of course, Gauss's law, as we derived it, states that the charge, sorry, the electric field flux integrated over any closed surface counts just the charge inside the surface. But that, I know, is not very satisfying because this sounds rather strange, funny, mysterious. Now, where did Gauss's law come? Gauss's law came from the 1 over r squared in Coulomb's law. Remember, because it was using the 1 over r squared that we proved Gauss's law, we derived Gauss's law for a sphere, and then we just pulled and pushed the sphere to generalize it. So it comes from 1 over r squared, it comes from Coulomb's law. To really answer this question in a way that satisfies you, that Gauss's law is equivalent really to Coulomb's law, you can do the following. You take the outside sphere. Consider the following problem. I have the first problem I did, okay? I have a spherical shell with charge on it. Or I have a conducting sphere and I understand that there is no charge inside. So I am looking at a point inside and there is charge outside. Okay. If I now don't know anything about Gauss's law, I look at every little piece of that surface. I can calculate the electric field from this bit of charge, which is not zero on that point. It's electric field is some field pushing this way, okay? Then from this point, there's an electric field contribution. From here, there's an electric field contribution. None of it is zero. Okay? If you add up as vectors all of these electric field contributions from all the little bits of charge in each little piece of area on your surface outside, you will find that because of the 1 over r squared in Coulomb's law and the charges being distributed equally all over the place, okay, you will get zero. You can show it. It is very difficult to show it because you have to do an integral of vectors whose directions change and whose distance from your point depends. It's not r because your point is not at the center. So it's a very complicated integral. But you can do that integral and it will show that it comes out to zero. Okay? This is a very good question because it shows you the also for people who are not going to be scientists or engineers in their later career. This is one of the important things about the way of thinking in science and mathematics. You try to always isolate the simplifying features, the symmetries in the problem. For example, in Gauss's law, we realize that for a sphere it is nice, okay, it holds. Then we ask the question, does it hold for other situations? And we found that it does. And it gives us the correct result. Automatically, Gauss's law says just count the charge inside. Okay? If you really ask your question, which is a good question, what about the charge outside? Gauss's law says it does not contribute when you add it all up. Okay? Provided, of course, that it is symmetrically distributed, so you have. You are right in choosing this spherical surface. Okay? If you didn't have Gauss's law, you would have to calculate this electric field, and of course you would get the same result. It will be zero from an outside shell. It is very difficult to calculate it. So the way we reason is if you identify some simple equivalent formulation, instead of Coulomb's law, use Gauss's law. Once you get that, then things become very easy to do. Okay? Now let us do the last part of this example. Now let me consider a situation where, well, a point inside my smaller isolating sphere. Go back to the picture and show it to you. So I've done all the rest. Now I want to consider a point here, for example. And then the spherical surface going through that point is something like that inside. Okay? So the integral in Gauss's law is easy to do again because everything is symmetric. The integral comes out the same way. Once again I have e times 4 pi r square for the left hand side. That's nice, symmetric, easy, done. Okay? On the right hand side, q inside where? At the radius r. Let's look at the picture, what this means. Now, Gauss's law tells me only use the charge enclosed inside your closed surface here. I know that the insulating sphere contains total charge q1. Where? Well, all over. So the charge inside my sphere here is not all of plus q. It is going to be less. And I have to calculate it. Right? How much? Well, I have to calculate the charge inside the sphere. I am told, it's given in the problem, that this charge is distributed uniformly across the volume. So per meter cube there is this much. So this density of charge I must multiply by the volume here, which is 4 pi over 3 times little r cubed. Okay? Does everybody understand this? Any questions? Now let's do it. Inside the volume of my imagined sphere, en öne lütfen. Yeni gelen beyefendi, en öne teşrif buyurun lütfen. Okay. So, how much charge is there inside my Gauss surface? Well, the volume of that surface is 4 pi over 3 little r cubed. And it contains a charge density q over plus q over 4 pi over 3 r1 cubed. And all of this stuff divided by epsilon 0. Okay? So I have E times 4 pi r square equals r cubed over r1 cubed q over epsilon 0. Is this clear? Questions? Clear? I can now add the direction by symmetry, it's going to be in the radial direction. So I have now figured out the electric field everywhere, starting from near zero, near the origin, inside my first sphere, between the first and second, and outside. Okay? Let me make a plot. We did three different applications of Gauss's law because we had three different situations inside the first ball, between the ball and the shell, and outside balls. Okay? Outside, E was zero because the total charge inside was plus Q minus Q cancelled. Inside, it only saw the charge inside, which was total plus Q. So it's Q over 4 pi epsilon 0 r square, just as if it was a single charge. Okay? Inside the ball, it's seeing a fraction of the total charge, and right at the center at the origin, the electric field is zero because it sees no charge inside there. Then, as you increase the volume from the center, it sees a bit of charge, which increases as altitude, and Coulomb law decreases r square, so the net electric field is just proportional to r. Until it gets to r equals r1. At that point, you get the same result, q over 4 pi epsilon 0, 1 over r1 square. From that point on, it goes as r square. Okay? We just use the spherical symmetry, chose spherical surfaces, realized E has to be radially outward, and then everything followed like that. Okay? Clear? Let me do one more example. Suppose you have a metal wire, you put some charge in it, this is conducting, so the charge will spread along the wire at equal density. Okay? I will assume that this wire is infinite. Now, no real wire is infinite. When I assume it's going to be infinite, it simply means that the places I'm interested in where I calculate electric fields and other things are at some distance from the wire, small compared to the length of the wire. Maybe the wire is 2 meters long, and I'm doing an experiment here within 10 centimeters, and I'm near the middle of the wire and not close to the end. Okay? Because at the end, there will be something complicated. When you say something is infinite, it really means you are close to the middle of it. Okay? So I'll say it's infinite. It's conducting, so the charge you put on it, wherever you put the charge, will just push each other out and spread out. So now that this is a thin wire, it will have a constant density, uniform density, per unit length. That's what I call lambda. Unit of that is coulombs per meter, maybe 5 coulombs per meter. Okay? And the question, of course, is to calculate the electric field. First, let us ask, if I want to calculate the electric field at this point here, what other points will have the same strength of the electric field? Right. What is that? What is this thing called? Diameter means chub. This thing is? It's a circle. Circumference is the length of the circle. Yes, you're right. It is a circumference. But I'm asking you, what shape is it? Okay. What is the figure in space on which all the points will feel the same electric field? Obviously, the electric field depends on perpendicular distance from this wire. Okay. So at all points on this circle, the strength of the electric field will be the same. What about if I move upward at the same radius? Along this circle, the electric field strength is still the same. As long as the line is infinite, that means as long as I'm close to the middle portions of my real wire, okay, the electric field is the same not only on this circle, on all circles. So in three dimensions, that figure is what? What is this? It's a cylinder, yes. So my glass surface must be a cylinder. So here's R. So now let me make a picture of my surface. Okay, this is my surface. Right? A cylinder. Next. What is going to be the direction of my electric field vector? Like this? 22.5 degrees from the vertical. Does it make sense? Maybe it is 39 degrees. Of course. There's only one special direction. If you give a Y, the only special direction at any point is away or towards the Y. Just like for a point, it is the radius direction out of a sphere. For a wire, the symmetry surface is a cylinder, and there is only one special direction, which is out or in, doesn't matter, but the radial direction. Okay? Here is a problem. Whenever we have a long wire, we have a problem with cylindrical symmetry, as we say. And for cylindrical symmetry, the direction of the electric field has to be away from the wire. What does away mean? Not away like this or like that. Okay? Away like this. Okay?
So it will be something that I want to calculate in the r direction.
Okay.
Now, to use Gauss's law, I need to have a closed surface. Now I've got the cylinder, but the top and the bottom are still open. To apply Gauss's law, I must close the surface. Why? Because only if you have a closed surface, you can measure what is inside. An open surface doesn't have an inside. Remember, Gauss's law talks about, as we proved, it uses the total charge inside the surface. To have an inside, it must be closed. Right? So you always first start choosing your surface using symmetry, then close it in the simplest possible way, again using symmetry. Now, shall I close my cylinder like this and that? How shall I close it? Okay, I give you 1 minute, you can just discuss with your friends, think about it and tell me. If I have a long cylindrical surface, what is a nice symmetric way to close the top and the bottom? I have a long chimney, and you want to close the top. Maybe you like a cone, or a nice sphere, or what? What's going to be easiest? Okay, you say we want a half sphere. Any other suggestions? Anybody think differently? I heard something. Plain. What kind of plane? This plane, that plane? Yes, the only special plane is this one. Now, that's the right answer, but let's start with this suggestion first. If you have a sphere, remember what I want to calculate with Gauss's law, I want to use the electric field direction perpendicular to the surface. If I have a sphere, the electric field, I already know that the electric field is this way. Sphere is like that. The electric field is not perpendicular to the surface, nor is it parallel to the surface. When you use Gauss's law, you try to choose surfaces on which the electric field is either perpendicular to the surface or parallel to the surface. I already know the electric field is like that. Okay? If I close with a plane, the electric field is itself parallel to the surface. So it gives no flux, it doesn't flow through the surface at all. And Gauss's law talks about, just like the flow of water in a river, how much the electric field arrows, the electric field vectors, go through your surface. Okay? So the idea is either choose a surface so that it goes fully through, it's perpendicular to the surface, or try to choose a surface that contains the electric field. The electric field is lying in the surface, so it doesn't go at all. Okay? So, this lady's suggestion is good. We want to choose a plane. So I have now closed my surface here with a plane on top, and I have to close it at the bottom also. Put another plane. Where am I going to put these planes? Well, if I put this one here, the important thing is what is the distance to the other plane, because I am now defining a closed cylinder, right? And I need, for my calculations, I need the height of this cylinder. Let me call this h. Let me call this h. Okay?
So to calculate it, I must calculate now the flux of the electric field going out through the curved cylindrical surface on the sides, plus any flux that goes through the top and the bottom. And Gauss's law says this will equal to how much charge there is inside. Well, this I know already, so let me just write it down. Right hand side of Gauss's law is, then I have lambda coulombs per meter, and inside my closed box I have h meters. So lambda h is the total charge. Is this clear? So depending on where I cut my top and bottom, h may be 10 centimeters, 1 meter, whatever. And lambda times that h is the charge inside. You always put how much charge is inside. It doesn't concern you that this wire is infinite and there's a lot of charge way out over the ceiling. Okay, that doesn't enter. You just look at what's inside your box. Okay, so it's lambda h, and there's our proportionality constant epsilon 0. Now, look at the figure. Over the top, the electric field is this way. ds, defining the flux going through, is this way. E dot ds is 0. Or inverse, if you say how much electric field is going through the surface, well, electric field is just grazing, it's along the surface. It is not going through at all. There is field, but there is no flux through the surface. Okay? And similar with the bottom surface. Now let's look at the sides. On the sides, E is perpendicular to the surface. So E is going fully through the surface. E is parallel to the ds vector. Remember, ds vector just reminds us what's the perpendicular direction to the surface. E dot ds tells us, is E going through the surface or not? Here, E dot ds is just E times ds. It's fully going through the surface, right? Is this clear? Now I can leave the figure and go on to the next page. Here E is perpendicular to the surface. Sorry, parallel to the surface, perpendicular to ds. E is parallel to surface, top and bottom. This means this is 0. Okay? So what I have now is this one. This equals E times integrate ds. Because E dot ds doesn't matter. You chose a nice simple surface. E dot ds is just E times ds. All of E goes through the surface. Moreover, on my cylindrical surface, at all points on that surface, E is the same in its magnitude. So it's E times integrate the surface equals lambda h over epsilon 0. Okay. What is the area of the surface? E times 2 pi r h. That's the area of a cylinder. 2 pi r, the circumference of the circle, times the height of the cylinder. Okay? H cancels. And I finally have E as a vector at any point r is simply lambda over 2 pi r epsilon 0. In what direction? In the r direction. In my problem, r is outward from the wire. Okay? Any questions? Now, here's an important point to check that you don't make mistakes in such problems. In my final result, h, the height of the cylinder, cancelled. It doesn't appear.
You should worry if you do a calculation and H appears. Because H is not something that comes from the system or from nature. H is what you put in. What was H? I just decided I put a plane here, put a plane there. And I arbitrarily decided the distance between them is 3 meters. I put in H. The system doesn't care about H. So in the real physical results, H should not appear. So the lesson from this is, in Gauss law applications, you choose the surfaces in the simplest possible way, the easiest symmetric surfaces, and such that E is the same everywhere on the surface, direction of E is either perpendicular or parallel to the surface. Then any other distances that you put in to close your box should not appear in the final result, because that's what you put in. It doesn't have anything to do with nature. Okay? So that's a good way to check if you made a mistake. If at the end you forgot to cancel the H and it's in your result, you should see an alert there. There's something wrong. Nothing that you put in by hand should appear in the physical result. All right? Okay. Now I go on to the next chapter, which is about parallel plate capacitors. I'll show you a picture first from the web. Any questions so far? You are getting the idea about Gauss's law, and as you solve problems, you'll get it just much better, okay? Takes some getting used to. All right. Here is a picture of a parallel plate capacitor. I start with considering the following thing. I have a number of charges. They are all equal, little, let's say, positive charges, these blue dots there. Okay. And at this point here, I want to measure the electric field. So I put a little test charge, plus 1 coulomb here, and measure the force. Okay, that's the electric field. I want to figure out what the electric field is. Okay. So I ask, let's calculate the electric field. Sorry, I should go back there. Here. Okay. Now, at this point, let me consider the contribution from this charge. It's going to give an electric field like that, away from this charge, and it's a vector like this. But there is a charge on the other side, at the same distance from my point. This guy will give an electric field of the same strength. The components of these two electric field contributions in the perpendicular direction to this are the same. What differs are the parallel components, which cancel. Clear? So the net result of this guy's contribution and this guy's contribution will be some field, I don't know how much, but obviously the contribution will be perpendicularly away from the plane. Okay? Now, similarly, the contribution of this guy and his partner, symmetrically located on the other side, will be perpendicular to the plane. Okay. Now I have an infinite plane. I show it as a line, but there are also guys on this, on all the other directions. Okay. Infinite means again I am close to the plane and far from the edges. Then, for any contribution from some charge here, I find a contribution from the symmetrically located other charge. And here and here and here and here, like that, okay? And each of these pairs of partners, their contributions, tangential parts, parallel to plane parts, will cancel. So, I can see from this argument that near an infinite plane of charge, the direction of the electric field must be out of the plane, perpendicular to the plane. Is this clear? Okay, here you see it, these two, and these two, and these two, you keep adding all the partners, okay, and you find that the total electric field has to be in the only special direction for a plane, which is its perpendicular. And if the plane is positively charged, then the electric field must be perpendicular and away from the plane. On this side. On the other side, it's like that. So the electric field from a plane is like this. Okay? If you assume now you have a big plane made of metal, conducting, you put some charge at one end, it will immediately spread out, and you have equal charge density. And then this thinking shows you that the field must be like that. Okay? Any questions? Now let's use Gauss's law to calculate the magnitude of the field. So far I just figured out its direction so that I can use the symmetry. Okay? So the charge per unit area, this is some plus sigma, and let's say this direction is z, okay, so I've seen that the electric field is parallel to z, c simulation on Sucors. Okay. Now, I want to calculate the electric field. Let's say at this position here. And the first question I ask is, at what other points the electric field should have the same magnitude as my point? Okay. What other points will have the same electric field? The electric field here should be the same or not? How about here? So, what is the shape of the surface on which the electric field is the same as my point? It's a parallel plane. Okay, it's an imaginary plane in the air, but it's parallel to my metal plate. Clear? Now I want to close my Gauss surface. So I want to find some other surfaces to add up to this blue surface to make a closed box. Okay? If I look at the other side of my charge distribution, now why am I looking at the other side? Because to use Gauss's law, the charge must be inside some box. Okay? So the box must close on the other side of this charge. Right? On the other side, if I go the same distance, suppose this distance is z, or let me call it, okay, let me call it z. If I go the same distance, z on the other side, down to minus z, okay, well, just distance z. The electric field on this surface will be pointing, of course, in opposite direction, but again it will be perpendicular to the plane, and whatever the electric field is, on the surface at minus c, it will have the same magnitude, same strength as here, because it's at the same distance from my plates. Is this clear? So now I've got a top and a bottom for my closed surface. Now I want to close it. So now I need sides. And I'll choose the sides perpendicular to the surface. Why? Because that way the electric field will not go through them. Okay? Let me now close my Gauss surface. I deliberately made an arbitrary shape, because whether it's a circle or a square or top of a piano or whatever, doesn't matter. We'll see that, okay? I just choose some funny shape on the top surface. I choose exactly the same shape on the bottom surface, and the sides are perpendicular to my metal plate. And this is an area A, and the bottom has, of course, the same area A. Now let's go on to Gauss. Right hand side of Gauss's law, how much charge is inside? Where there was sigma charge per unit area, and I chose an area A. So there is sigma A of charge in Coulombs, and here is my proportionality constant epsilon 0. Okay? Now everybody stop writing and answer questions. Let's do it together. You can write it later. Let's start with this bit. On the sides here, the electric field is parallel to the surface. It is not going through the surface. So E dot ds, or the question, how much electric field is actually going through this side surface, is zero. Clear? Why? Because on the sides, E parallel to surface, which is the same thing as saying E is perpendicular to ds. Ds, remember, is the direction perpendicular out of the surface. Okay? So E dot ds is zero. Now, in the top and the bottom, E is directly perpendicular to the surface. So E is fully along ds. E dot ds is just E times ds. Moreover, everywhere over this area, E is a constant, so I can take it out of the integral. So this is just equal to E times A plus this guy, which is another E times A. Is this clear? So 2EA equals sigma A over epsilon 0. E is sigma over 2 epsilon 0 because A cancelled. Again, the same point. If A didn't cancel, you should worry. Because I put in the A. I even put in a funny shape. Doesn't matter. Shouldn't matter. Okay? So what have I learned? If I have a parallel plate, if I have just one plane metal with charge, the electric field is pointing away perpendicularly, and its magnitude is sigma over 2 epsilon 0. What happened to z, the distance from the plate? It doesn't appear. So the electric field here, or here, or here, or right next to the surface, all have the same magnitude. This is something unexpected. If you have a parallel plate, if you have a plane with charge on it, the electric field strength doesn't decay as 1 over r square. With a point charge, it decays as 1 over r square. Decreases as 1 over r square. With a wire, it decreases as 1 over r. With a plane, it does not decrease or increase at all. The electric field strength is constant. Okay? So now I have a picture. You can visualize the electric field. The electric field is like this. Okay. Now I'll tell you what happens next. If you have a parallel plate capacitor, that means you have a plane with charge plus Q, and you have another plane with charge minus Q. This says sigma equals Q over A, and this says sigma equals minus Q over A, okay? Now, this guy gave this field by itself. This guy gives, of course, because it's negative, the electric field is directed inward like this. And again, it has the same value. Okay, let me now make a picture. Or let me just show it to you. I'll put it in the notes later and you can read because you are getting late. If you have one plus charge plate, this is its field. Keep this in mind. If you have a minus charge plate here, this is its field. If you are over here, the total electric field is this from the minus guy, and this from the plus guy, it's zero. If you are above the plus guy, upper plate, its electric field contribution is this, but from the bottom plate, it is this. It doesn't depend on distance, so it cancels. So between the plus and minus Q, there is some field. But outside, above and below, the plus and minus plates fields cancel. In between, the plus does this, and the minus does this. So it adds twice, because the values are equal. This plus this is simply twice one of them. So in between the plates, the field is simply sigma over epsilon zero. Okay? Any questions? Now we have finished the chapter on the parallel plate capacitor. On the week after your holiday, I will do Ampere's law on Monday and Wednesday. You already learned this in your experiment, but I will do it in detail here, how to use it, etc. And Gauss, Coulomb, Ampere, and the ideal gas law will be included in your midterm. Everything up to next Thursday after the midterm. So during, I give lots of homework so you can study. Okay? And reading is both chapter 1 of Feynman, which is about gases, and chapter 11 of Gribbin, which is a very nice story about how these electric things were discovered. Okay?